Right now, we're going to go stay in D.C. a little. Eliska Anacostia, that's where she was raised. Kola Boof. Kola Boof, welcome to WOL. Is Kola there? I just spoke to her, so I know she's there hanging out. Anyway, while we get Kola on the air, let me just tell you, some of you who don't know, Kola is the former mistress of Osama bin Laden, and she's going to tell you how that came about. And she's also got a new book out, and it's called, let me see if I get the title here, it's called The Sexy Part of the Bible, or The Sexiest Part of the Bible. It's a controversial book, and she'll talk about that, also about a conflict that she had with Amir Baraka, who, by the way, he died last week, and the wake is tonight, actually, in Newark, New Jersey. Reverend Jackson is going to be there, and a lot of other civil rights leaders are going to be there as well for a sending home party for, if you will, sending home, if it's a party, you know, for Amir Baraka, it's going to be a party. That's what's going to happen today, one of our most prolific writers. But anyway, some people like our next guest, and some people can't stand her. Kola, I've interviewed many times before in the first book, and some people are upset with her. But she's got some very strong views, so you either like her or love her. She's one of those kind of persons. And she talked about the marriage with Bin Laden and a deal with Islam. She talks about Christianity, too. And they say that she hates all Christians, so this is going to be interesting. And she gets involved in the anti-gay debate, the new law that's been implemented into Nigeria, where being homosexual is against the law in Nigeria. A lot of African countries are doing that. And a lot of them, when they did that, the UK announced that they were going to withhold money. You know, the UK is still supporting many of these former groups. So in a moment, we'll get Kola. If you can call back, because I know she's calling me on my cell. And if somebody's in the studio, we'll pick up the phones. We'll really kind of appreciate it. We seem to have these problems at the time, all the time at this time. Anyway, but that's the deal. Kola Boof is going to come up, and she was born in Sudan, but she grew up in Anacostia, so she wants to make sure that to know that, because she's still got some friends in that area of D.C. She's Sudanese. She described herself as an Egyptian Sudanese American. I'm going to ask her why, not just an African American, why an Egyptian Sudanese American. And she's written several books, by the way. And she's also married. She is a part of an interracial marriage, you know, and she has children. She will talk about that, because she mentioned that she has passion for black men, but she says that black men don't like dark skinned sisters. So that's going to be an interesting conversation, because she says most of and she'll tell you too about when she got into the scrap with Amir Baraka. They were at a book festival in Harlem, and she just hauled off and slapped him one. And, you know, it made the news quite a bit, you know, because he says she called him a name. But I'm going to let her tell you the story. But anyway, because I know she has, I guess she regretted doing that, losing her temper. And she said she was provoked. But I'll let her tell the story, because a lot of times people, they only hear one side of the story. So a lot of people, because, you know, they're Amir Baraka, they know who he is. They've heard his side of the story. We haven't heard her side of the story. So a lot of people, this is going to be a first for many people. But when we come back, we're going to take a break. We've got a traffic and weather update. We'll come back with Kola Boof. Again, the number to call, speak to her, is 800-450-7876. That's 800-450-7876. Or you can find me on Facebook or Twitter. Some people already have given me questions for her. That's carlnelsonshow.com on Facebook or Twitter. You got a comment, a question. Kola already got two. So we'll take your calls in about 2.5 minutes. Staying with us, folks. Of course, you know, let me give you the numbers again so you can reach us at 800-450-7876. That's 800-450-7876. Or you can hit me up on Facebook and Twitter. If you can't get through, at carlnelsonshow.com. Our guest is Kola Boof. And Kola, welcome to WOL.
Hey, Carl. Thank you for having me on. We finally got each other.
Yeah, it's been a while. We'll work out. Trust me. Well, congratulations on your new book. The Sexiest Part of the Bible.
Right, The Sexy Part of the Bible. Thank you so much. It has really been acclaimed, and, you know, it's a really important book. I'm glad that so many black women are, you know, embracing it and not being ashamed of, you know, a lot of times Black women get upset if you talk about issues of color and, you know, wearing blonde hair and issues like that. And so I just love how Black women love the book, and they're like, you know, it's really true that, you know, our natural beauty is beautiful, you know, without the weave, without the all that.
Right. Before we get into the book, though, Kola, can you give us some background? Because some of these listeners, for you and I, it's been a while, but for, and some other folks who know about you, but I'm sure there's a lot of people who don't know about you. So just give us the tell us how we got to where we are right now.
I am an Egyptian Sudanese American author. I was born in Omdurman, Sudan, to Harith bin Farouk and Jiddi. And my mother is a Black one. My father was Arab. They were murdered in front of me because my father fought against slavery in Sudan. I was adopted and raised by Marvin and Claudine Johnson in Washington, D.C. I came to America when I was age 8. I grew up on Good Hope Road in Southeast Washington, D.C. They had also there was 8 children altogether. 4 of us were adopted. And I grew up and had some very unfortunate things happen in my life. Most people think of me as the mistress of Osama bin Laden. That is what the most press I have gotten. And so most people think, oh, that lady who was with Osama bin Laden. And, but, you know, I have a thriving writing career. I've been a novelist before I was with him. And that's really what I am, is a writer and a womanist. You know, womanist is like an African feminist. And I wrote for Days of Our Lives and Young and the Restless. So if you love E.J. Demira, I created that character. And a lot of people loved Drusilla's last year on Young and the Restless, which I was the one who wrote that. And so that's pretty much everything I can think about me. I love everything, Carl, right? Nelson.
And call it, well, let's go straight to it with Osama bin Laden. How did you hook up with him?
I was in a restaurant in Morocco back in 1996, January of 1996. I came in with my date, who was a Senegalese soccer player. And Osama bin Laden and his men came in, and he pretty much just had his men escort my date out and started talking to me. And he was attracted to me initially because I am, like, you know, I'm about 6'3", and Osama is like 6'7", 6'6", I would say 6'6". And so, you know, the height attracted him, and to him I was very beautiful. I was an actress model back in 1996. This is quite a long, you know, almost 20 years ago. And he took me over to his table, and then, of course, he learned that I speak fluent Egyptian Arabic. And that I am half Egyptian and half Arab and, you know, all these things. Well, at least that's what I thought, because it turns out that he knew all about me from Hassan al-Turabi, who was the vice president of Sudan at that time. And I had been involved with Turabi, the vice president of Sudan, and Turabi is the mentor of Osama bin Laden. So it turns out Osama had a lot of knowledge about me. But, you know, that's how it started, was basically he just, you know, in the Arab world, there's no such thing as dating. You don't get to, especially women who are unprotected, who, you know, my hair was uncovered, which is a sign of an American. I looked very Black American, but then I'm still Arab, you know, and had been born Muslim and all these things. So he just took over my life. And La Masana Rob, it's now a bed and breakfast hotel in Morocco. But at that time, Prince Rasouli, who is the owner of it, was he was remodeling the whole place. And while it was being remodeled, people were allowed to rent the rooms as they had been doing before. It's a Moorish castle, but it was used for only rich people at first. Now anyone can go there and rent the rooms. And if you go there now, you'll find the orange cake has been renamed Kola Boof cake, which is just so funny to me. But because I love the orange sponge cake that they make in the wall, and they serve it with fire and everything. And they have, Prince Rasuli has now renamed it the Kola Boof cake. But it was terrible to know him. You know, I never loved him. And I really wish that people would stop saying, oh, she was, you know, sleeping with Osama. She loved him. You know, when you're dealing with men of that caliber, who are very powerful, powerful men, they have, you know, Osama was a billionaire. He had untold, unlimited power. When I went to the police to try to escape him, they called Osama and turned me over to him. When my car vanished and I went to the police saying, you know, this man raped me the other night and now my car has vanished. He keeps coming to my room with his men. They told me I was imagining things, that I never had a car. And so,
and this is in Morocco? You know, Kola, what country were you in?
I was in Morocco when this
and
all
he
happened.
And he was in Morocco as well.
Right, because Osama used to come to Morocco to hunt. He loved to hunt snipe, which is a real bird there. I know in America they have a legend of a snipe that doesn't really exist, but in Morocco, the snipe is a real actual kind of duck that has like a black dot on its bottom. And it's the hardest duck to catch, and that's what Osama loved to come there for. He also went there, of course, to hide, and he went to Dukla all the time. Dukla was his favorite city because of the sword fishing, and he loved fishing and all that kind of stuff. And this is what I would do with him on Fridays. Tuesdays and Thursdays, Osama prayed all day long, and then on Fridays, he would go hunting. You know, and people have this such a wrong image of him in America. Tuesday and Thursday is really the only days Osama prayed. He's not how people think. Osama was a pothead. All the stuff that has come out now in the past 3 or 4 years that the American press has started telling you about the porn, all of this. I wrote about this over 10 years ago. My book, Diary of a Lost Girl, was published over 10 years ago. And people called me a liar. They said that, oh, she's making up stories. But now, all of a sudden, the American media, now that Osama died, and they went in and got all his belongings and found all the porn that I told everybody about. It was black women porn at that. You know, now this is in the British newspapers. The sex phones, which I described to a T, because now they're saying, you know, he had a very intricate cell phone. And all of this is in my autobiography written over 10 years ago. So now I don't know if you know the Roseanne Barr show, but I was on Roseanne Barr about 2 weeks ago, you know, talking about it, because now everyone is like, oh, how does she know all this? And so, you know, Osama was so different from what people think. He had a huge crush on Whitney Houston. That was like a daily thing. And Saddam Hussein, as the New York Times has now put out there, used to play Whitney Houston every day as well. I don't know what it is about these Arab leaders and Whitney Houston, because also Arafat was a huge, they were all Whitney Houston fanatics. And so, but Osama wanted to marry her and was just crazy about her. And they had, you know, like I said, he smoked a box of marijuana a day. I mean, I'm not exaggerating. I mean, there were like four people whose job was to just roll the marijuana. And Osama and his friends, I mean, his beard just smelled like it was a big marijuana patch. You know, and so people now are starting to believe me, to understand that, you know, as well as being all these things that, well, I'm not going to get into what he's actually done, because I don't really know that Osama blew up that building. I have no proof of that. he never discussed that with me. I don't know anything about that. But I'm just saying the things that I do know he has done. I was there when he ordered certain people to be killed. And he always cried about it. He was extremely sensitive. He's nothing like what the people in the West think. He never yelled, never raised his voice. He was very soft-spoken. He was brutal, you know, sexually and things like that. But he was very soft-spoken and really could be demonic at times. But at the same time...
Hang on a second, Kola, because we've got to take a break here at the bottom there. I'll let you finish up on Osama. We're going to talk about Amir Baraka as well. And also about your new book and the gay rights struggle. We're also going to talk about the browning, as they call it, in the Caribbean, and skin bleaching on the continent with the sisters and some of the brothers are involved in, too. And you wrote about that as well. Folks, you too can join the conversation with Kola Boof. It's 800-450-7876. We'll take your calls in about 2.5 minutes. And thank you for staying with us, folks. Our guest is writer Kola Boof. And I just want to remind you, Monday, King Day, Dr. Ben Chavis is going to be here. Also, some folks who were behind the actual, the reason why we have the Martin Luther King birthday holiday. Folks who were there with the rally with Stevie Wonder. We're going to hear some secrets that went down. The rally right in D.C. 31 years ago. You'll learn. So keep checking us out and stay with us on Monday on King Day. Right now, as I mentioned, we got Kola Boof. And those of you who may think it's kind of far-fetched. She's talking about Osama bin Laden, the most wanted man in the world. Well, let me just add that there was a fellow who told the BBC who collaborated that you were actually with Osama bin Laden. Are you aware of that? That it's been corroborated by a diplomat, a Sudanese diplomat?
Yeah, I know about him, but his book is a lie, unfortunately, because he is, of course, he corroborates it because he was there. He knows, you know, he's one of the people mentioned in my own book. But the problem with the diplomat is he's claiming that I was in love with Osama and that my son, my oldest son, is by Osama. If you look at my oldest son, his father is clearly a black man, pure black. I mean, both of my sons have the same father. I only have two children. Both of my sons are by a chocolate black man. And to look at them, I mean, it's just, you know, but that's what he's claiming is that my son is by Osama and that I really was a Muslim and just ridiculous things. But I wanted to say, because when you cut me off, I was about to say the difference with Osama. He also wrote the most beautiful poetry I've ever read. You know, so this is where people have been upset with me is that I don't paint a cartoon picture of Osama. In my autobiography, he's a real person, and I deal with him as a real. His mother, Hamida, was the only person who would talk to me after he died. That's the way I found out he really died, because at first I didn't believe it. I thought, if you're not going to show me a body, then this is just propaganda. He's not really dead. And when I
talked to him, let me ask you this, because some people said he was actually killed months or years before.
Well, according to his mother, because not only was he killed that night, but I believe his brother was killed and one of his daughters. But his mother and his son both confirmed to me that he was killed that night, just the way the American government says. Now, his mother especially, there's no way the Americans could get her to lie. So I don't know. There's always rumors, and, you know, I get people every day, Carl, who write to me claiming he's still alive, that, you know, he's alive and this and that. I have nightmares about Osama, so I don't want him to be alive personally. You know, he was very abusive to me, and I knew him to be very racist against blacks or Africans. You know, but at the same time, had sexual fetish for African women. And, you know, people forget that I worked for Hosni Mubarak. That's how I met Colin Powell. Colin Powell came to Sharm el-Sheikh. Colin Powell came to Sharm el-Sheikh. Right in 1995, when I was a hostess working for Hosni Mubarak, and I also worked for Muammar Gaddafi at White Bride when he was writing the Green Book. I was one of the people who worked on that. And so it just, I find it ridiculous that people, I don't know what it is. I think it's because I'm a dark-skinned black woman with nappy hair, that people just cannot envision North Africa the way it really is. That beautiful, dark-skinned black women also have cosmopolitan entree into this world. I don't know what it could be. I mean, that's all I can go by, is because the white press, when they heard my real name is Naima Bintadio. It's Naima Bintadio. That's my real name. I just used Kola Boof, which is a poem that I wrote, as, you know, my stage name, so to speak. And so when the U.S. press heard Naima Bintadio, they envisioned Cher. You know, they thought of an Arab woman who will look like Cher. People forget that many of us Arabs are deep, deep, dark black. And so I have just been caught up in that whole, you know, if I was white, they wouldn't be saying this story is outlandish or far-fetched, or, you know, they're saying it because it's a dark black woman who is, you know, and for black American men, I am also not the beauty standard. You know, not just white people, but black American men have said, make comments like, he could have any woman he wants. Why would he want her? You know, and I'm actually quite striking. I mean, I'm, like I said, I'm 6'3", 44 double D breasts that are all natural, a really nice backside, extra long legs, and Osama claimed that my face was this exquisitely beautiful, a work of art, according to him. So, you know, it's that whole, it's race. It's race when people say, you know, I don't believe her story, I don't this, I don't that. You can't make up lies against, you know, don't Americans realize it's a federal offense to make up lies against the FBI?
And I want to mention this, let me interrupt you for a second. Were you debriefed by U.S. authorities on this at all?
Yes, that's what I was about to say, is that they're in my autobiography. If I'm, you know, how can I write about the NSA and what corrupt criminals I feel they are personally, but what I went through with the NSA is just a shocking story within itself. And now all of a sudden people are saying, oh, you know, she wasn't so crazy 10 years ago when she was telling us that the NSA were surveillancing her and were surveillancing her children. I mean, all of this, Carl, I came on your show at least 7 years ago and was telling all this, and people were laughing and saying, oh, she's this and that. And I named names in my autobiography. Everyone's name is named. I was questioned for over 2 months at that thing that you guys call the Pentagon. They kept taking me there and having me there for, you know, just over and over. The place where Osama ended up being killed is like 2 miles from the place I said he was at. And this is my autobiography. I can't go back and change it. If you read it, you will read that I wrote all this over 10 years ago of where he was, everything. And so now there has been suddenly some of the white journalists writing me, apologizing, saying, you know, everything you said is being proven one by piece by piece, you know, and I have no reason to lie. Who wants to tell people that they were with Hitler? What will you get from that? People threw bricks at me and my children. We have no desire to be, you know, if I'm going to pick someone to lie about, why wouldn't I pick someone popular who people will think it's a good thing? But no, nobody thinks it's good to be the mistress of Osama bin Laden. So it has made me very unpopular. I lost so much work. I was fired from Days of Our Lives. You can go online and read all about how that took place. Jif peanut butter and Tide detergent. Those two sponsors demanded that I be fired because they said that they don't have proof that I didn't like him. That for all they know, I'm really a Muslim, and I'm just, you know. And that has been another thing, is people insist that, you know, I was born Sunni Muslim, so I like Osama, and I really am a Muslim. And that is the book that you're referencing, that the diplomat in Sudan, there's actually two Sudanese diplomats who have come out saying that, you know, I was just a whore. You know, and I don't deny that part as far as being a whore. By standards of religious people, I probably was, you know, I was with Hassan al-Tarabi. I was with several men in the Egyptian and Sudanese government. And I was kind of being passed around. So, you know, I don't deny that. But what I do deny, my son is not by Osama bin Laden, and I deny that this idea that I loved Osama. I was with Osama because he forced me to be there, and then he just abruptly got tired of me and let me go. And he had many women. I mean, this is what people don't understand. He had women everywhere. I was just the chick in Morocco. I mean, literally. He had four wives. First, and I had to take abuse from the lead wife. You know, it was just terrible situation there. And to not only go through it, but then to have people call you a liar and, you know, all this kind of stuff. But that was the reality of my life at that time. I survived Osama bin Laden, and I'm grateful that I have gotten away from him in one piece. And I pray that I will continue to be safe. Because these are very dangerous men. Some of them are on my side, because don't think that I don't have my own army. I have my own men in the Arab world who are on my side, but I'm just saying.
Hang on a second, Kola, because we've got to take a break. When we come back, Jay in New York wants to talk to you. He's got a question to you. Folks, if you want to have a question for Kola Boof, the number to call is 800-450-7876. That's 800-450-7876. We're going to talk about Amira Baraka as well, and also talk about her latest book, A Sexy Part of the Bible. We'll take your calls for Kola Boof in about 2.5 minutes.
Based on white supremacy and the struggle that we face in this country and in Africa.
All right. And with that, call, I'm going to let you answer this question as well, because they said, make sure you ask her why she has joined forces with white supremacy to oppress African males. And that was from Patrice and Layla. Two people online were asking the same question.
First a minute, can I answer
this? Hang on a second, Jay. Let her respond. Go ahead, Kola.
Yeah, let me respond. First of all, I call all black people who are sex haters nigger stock. That refers to all black people worldwide, not just black American men, but black people who bleach their skin in Nigeria, black people who sell black children into slavery, all of the black people who are against blackness worldwide, I refer to them as nigger stock. This whole thing about me hating black American men is a big lie. I don't hate black American men. Those men are my preference. They don't like black women. They judge us totally by our skin complexion, our hair texture. You cannot deny that. We are judged for not being white enough. And for that to be treated to an African woman, then you're just as bad as any white supremacist as far as I'm concerned. My white husband, as you know, Kim, was the person who loved me, accepted me, and came after me. Black men had the number one chance with me. So that's insulting when you try to claim, you know, this is so, first of all, because we're not the same country. You know, I'm from a different culture, and even though I was raised by black Americans, the fact that I am African and have come from a country where everyone is black and where I know how important from my tribe, you know, I come from a tribe and a clan. My tribe is Oromo. My clan is Chigwok. So I understand the importance of black people loving black people. But in America, black American men consistently and always place every woman but a black woman on a pedestal in front of me. And then you expect me to marry a black man. That is what is so unfair. You always put a Latina in front of me, always put Korean, white, everything in front of me. Mariah Carey is not a black woman to me. Alicia Keys is not even a black woman where I'm from. So you're always putting these light, 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 bright women in front of us. Then you have the audacity to be upset that I'm upset at black men and that I married a white man. Who was I going to marry, Jay? Who was I supposed to marry? Only thing black men offer me, Jay, is a hard penis. You know, that's only thing black men want to do. I have a great body and all that. She, you know, I would do her. But how many black men are talking about I would put a $12,000 ring on her finger, give her a brand new car, and marry her and take care of her children? a white man did that, unfortunately. And he's Jewish, too. So, you know, a lot of black people are angry at that. But that's who came and took, and, you know, and I talked about this with Iman, Naomi Campbell, well, all these black women, we've talked about this. And, you know, you're downing us for being with white men, but black men do not come after us. They don't, you know, they're sending rings in the mail. Look at these black athletes. They're sending million-dollar diamond rings in the mail to white waitresses, white strippers. And she has to be white. You know, Kim Kardashian is your idea of an African queen. So who's being disrespected here? I can't even watch BET and see a black woman in any of the black men's music videos and stop blaming it on white men. Black men, like Sister Soulja said, are the ones who, and Lauryn Hill also said, black men are the ones who decide who ends up modeling in their videos. They handpick those girls, and they don't think black women are beautiful. I'm a nappy-headed African woman from, you know, what are you mad at me for when you don't even want me?
All right, let's give Jay a chance to respond. Jay?
This is what I'm saying, you know, unfair of him and this woman. And I will continue calling, but when, let me give you a good example without using the profanity. There are black teenage boys, and this is at any mall across America. You go to the mall, and these black teenage boys are saying, I would not have sex with a black woman with somebody else's, you know, penis. I wouldn't use somebody else's, you know. These are the kind of comments regularly made about black women by black American teenage boys who were raised by the woman who's, you know, women like the woman coming in to denounce me. You have a society where black women are judged solely on their looks. No respect is given to them. You know, people, the way black women are treated in America is just an absolute travesty and a holocaust. But then you want to put all these conditions on black women and respect. And I will continue to call people nigger stock. I think that is the perfect word that Malcolm X would have used if he was alive. He would applaud.
Let's give Jay a chance to respond. Thanks, Kola. Get Jay?
First of all, Carl, now, she made the assertion in regards to Mariah Carey and Alicia Keys. Now, isn't that what she's doing by having a baby with the Jew boy? Isn't that the same thing? So what is she going to classify her child if she has the child with the Jew boy? Also,
well, you should have asked that. Wait a minute. We're not having children. We already announced when we got married that we weren't having children. So that's not even an issue. My sons are both black by a black man. Now, tell me what black men can say the same. While you're on here debating and ripping me to shreds, what black hero of yours can say he also has children by a black woman? I mean, does Nick Cannon's children look black to you? They don't look black to me. Well, who are your heroes that are black men that have had a black son? If you love black men so much, why are you black men so, you know, refuse to give birth to a black man? Why are your children look white and Filipino and Haitian? Well, not Haitian, but Hawaiian is what I meant to say. If you love black men so much, why do you black men refuse to produce black men? At least I produce two black men. Give me credit for that.
All right, Jay?
I date white women. I don't date light-skinned women. I'm into African women with
okay.
dark.
All right, because it's getting down to the personal level. Jay, thanks for your call, because I'm going to keep moving. 800-450-7876. It's tit for tat, tit for tat. Both of you are holding your ground, and we understand that. Before I take another call, though.
And I love Jay. I just want to say I love Jay. And I'm sorry that I didn't meet you, Jay. Maybe if I had been to New York and I met you, because he sounds like maybe he's the kind of man who would have done, you know, but that's how life is. We don't meet the one who we don't know where they are. I love black men. I love black men, and I would have been so much even my husband knows this, that I would have been really happy if a black man had been the one who, you know, I think almost every black woman that I know that's with a white man has told me the same thing, that they wish a black man had come for them.
Wow. Interesting. 800-450-7876. Kola Boof is his name. Kola, we're coming up on a break. So I'm going to ask you this question that someone texted here. It says, please ask Ms. Boof to explain some of the pain she feels in her life as expressed in her poem, Everybody Lied on Me.
That was a good example, was just now the confrontation with me and Jay, is that, you know, people see things that you do and they don't, especially when you're women, they take less time to investigate what happened. We don't have power, Carl, over our lives. A lot of young girls, if a man finds you attractive and he has enormous power and you are poor and you don't have, you know, we are not protected by the police either. And so a lot of people are taken over and go into situations that was the best they could do at that time. And so when I said everybody lied on me, the pain of that, you know, having my vagina infibulated as an infant because Islamic Arab men, where I'm from, I was born Sunni Muslim, and so in my culture, they cut us when we're little to make our vaginas extremely tight, and it will never untighten, it won't unloosen, you're like that forever. And
all right, hold that thought right there, Kola, because we got to take a break here at the top of the hour. We got some folks who want to talk to you. Folks, you want to talk to Kola Boof. They're also going to talk about Amira Baraka, that confrontation as well. Also about her latest book, Sexy Part of the Bible. And that's, I think that's what you're hearing is interesting. This, that other part, too, is very, very interesting, very provocative. 800-450-7876. That's the number to call. Speak to Kola Boof. Take your calls in about 2.5 minutes. And thank you for staying with us, folks. And thank you for those of you who are joining us. Again, a lot of folks hitting us up with emails and Facebooks and tweets about Kola Boof. 800-450-7876. And before I go back to the calls, Kola, can you tell us about, and if you can shorten up on the answers, I'd appreciate it, because a lot of people want to speak to you. But if you could tell us about the dust up with Amira Baraka, because today is actually not the funeral, the services are tomorrow, actually. What they call it, going home services is tonight, actually, in Newark, and Jesse Jackson's there as well, and a lot of other civil rights leaders. But what happened there before we take some more calls?
Well, Amira Baraka and I were on the same publisher, and unfortunately, there was an incident where I was speaking, and basically all the men in the auditorium, including Amira, became extremely hostile and disrespectful to me in the auditorium because I was speaking on colorism in the black community and the treatment of black women in the black community. And they started, you know, cursing at me and denying what I was saying. So I pointed out that most of the so-called black power men in the audience, their women aren't even black. And, you know, the women were there. I was like, look, most of these women up here in the front don't even look like black women. And yet you're claiming what I'm saying is not true. How is this the black community where black women are not, you know, authentic black women are not put in the front ever? So they were upset and they called me the B word, Amira especially, and, you know, were very, very hurtful and disrespectful to me. So as I was walking off the stage and out, Amira jumped up and, you know, said a whole lot of really horrible things. And I went over and just slapped them. And everyone was just, of course, enraged and, you know, upset. And they were especially upset because when the police came, and no one, of course, hit me or attacked me, they weren't able to catch me. My bodyguard. But
you broke up a little bit. What happened after the police came? Because you broke it. We lost you.
When the police came, Amira decided not to press charges against me for slapping him. And what I want people to understand is that I love Amira Baraka. I grew up reading. He is one of the men. The reason that Kola has so much courage and it speaks like this and is out there is because of Amira Baraka. He made me who I am. I was able to tell him that later after that horrible event, that I have a right to speak for women's rights without being called the B word and all this and that. And as far as I'm concerned, Amiri Baraka made up. I consider him to be the father of Kola Boof, him and Derek Bell, and so many great black men leaders who have inspired my whole life since I was a kid, especially Malcolm X and Marcus Garvey. But Amiri Baraka is one of the fathers of Kola Boof, and fathers and daughters fight. And that fight was years ago. It's over. Him and I made up. I love Amiri Baraka, and I just send my whole heart to him in heaven, letting him know that he is cherished by me. My sons read his books. For Christmas, they got all his books. Both boys got all his books, and he signed two of them. And so his family loves Amiri Baraka, me and my sons. And I will always be someone who praises him. Nothing but good things to say about the incident. People need to just let go. Because, okay, like I said, fathers and daughters fight. It was a misunderstanding. He did not mean for me to be ganged up on by all the men in the audience. And so, you know, it was just water under the bridge. But we love each other. And we should all have that same feeling. We should all trust over these things and love each other.
All right, let's take some calls. I'm glad that that's squared away. Hopefully everybody's cool with that. 800-450-7876. Go to line 3. Abdul is joining us from Seattle, Washington. Abdul, you're on with Kola Boof. Is Abdul there? Okay, let's try line 4. Catherine in D.C.
Yes, I was coming home from work when I heard this, so I couldn't pick it all up. And I was glad that you asked the young lady to give her name. I'm not familiar with it, but I can certainly agree with many of the things that she has said. I was not shocked or surprised or taken back. I don't understand the name calling of her because she found or got her soulmate or got the person, whether he be Caucasian or not, because many of my friends I hear all say the same thing who are black women. Some who have made it to the top who tell me that when they go to, if they're at the top of the ladder in business world, and when they go to the meetings, that the African-American males who are there, they don't even look like they see them. That it's almost like they don't want it to be known, or like, you know, they don't want to gravitate toward the black woman, but they will indeed talk and have conversations with the white women. Now, one of my girlfriends in particular, you know, somebody would look at her and say, she's not a beauty queen, but you know what? The white men eat at her feet. Her brilliance, her mind, and they're kind. They're not talking about her butt, her lips, her hair, or any. They're not looking at any of that. And unfortunately, what my sister said is so true, that oftentimes we first, sure, the eye, you're going to be attracted to that. But we carry that a bit too far. Wherein, and my girlfriends tell me, the guys, basically the ones that I know, they talked about were the Caucasians. They don't even look at their legs or how big or how skinny, or their butt, how flat or how big, or their hair, whether it's kinky, straight, or what. But they look beyond that. And so there should be no upsetment. Yes, just as she said, they too, they would have loved to have had a black brother to, you know, tall, black, handsome, intelligent. But they don't even look at them when they go to the meetings and they go to sessions. I myself have been places. And you sometimes when you're not that, there are not that many of us in, it's sort of natural when you see someone that looks like yourself to try to get eye contact. They're not looking for anybody to jump on anybody. They're just looking for the eye contact. They look right past you. And so she's absolutely right.
All right, Catherine. Thank you.
You know what the thing is?
I wish there are many, many African-American women out here, single women. Yeah. And you know what? The brothers don't even see them. And my contention is at this point, whoever comes, if he looks and he's all right and he's got the character and all the other things, then not because you wouldn't want a black brother, but the black brothers are not there.
Okay. Right. Thanks, Catherine. Okay. Kola?
Yeah, and Carl, you have interviewed me several times, and I think you know that you know, I don't hate black men. I do criticize black men a lot for just what she just said, the colorism. But that's basically just me being mad that they aren't giving me attention that I feel as an African woman, I deserve at least a hello, at least a look. And so, you know, she's right what she's saying. But trust me, Carl, I don't hate black men. I really don't. And I feel sad, though, that some black men, you know, think that. You know, and I'm 44 years old. I don't have time left. You know, I have to take care of my sons. They need to go to college. I have so many things that are needed. You know, try to think like a woman, as a woman, and what a woman has to achieve, and you will understand more that women pick for a whole different reason than black men. I really don't care about pretty hair and all that kind of stuff. I really just need someone to help me be secure.
All right. I tell you what, hang on, Kola, because we've got to take some more calls. Let's try again and see if we can get Abdul on line three.
Okay.
Seattle. Is Abdul there on line three?
Hello.
All right. Go ahead. Abdul, you're on with Kola Boof.
Hear me?
Yes, we can hear you now.
Carl, can you hear me?
Sure.
This is Askia. This is not
Abdul. Oh, Askia on line two. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Okay. You know what, Carl? I hope you have enough time because I know you're coming up to a break. But I'd really, really like to talk to this sister. You know, the only thing about any story in life, there's always another story to go along with it. It's the other side. And to see two experiences in life and hear two women talk about this, the same life almost the same time and have two different experiences. Nat Nicole comes to mind. She wrote a book about her mother telling her did not even deal with dark-skinned men. And I say this point to say this, my sister, that I feel your pain, so I can't holler at you.
Well, hang on a second, Eskia, because we got to take a break. You're right. We're coming up on a break.
Okay.
Right. I did see that book that Natalie Cole wrote about, which is interesting because Nat King Cole was you know, his dark brother. He, you know, there's no question. He was famous and had money, but he was black. 800-450-7876, number to call. Speak to Kola Boof. We'll take a break. Also, you can reach me on Facebook and Twitter at carlnelsonshow.com. We'll take your calls for Kola Boof in about 2.5 minutes. And thank you for joining us, folks. Our guest is Kola Boof. She's a writer, of course. She was friends with Ben Loudon. We got on that. She dust up with Amari Baraka. But I'll tell you what, those of you online, if you just put in a question for him, because a bunch of folks want to speak to her, I got another bunch of questions for her as well. So let's go back to Eskia in California. Eskia, you're on with Kola Boof.
And I say this, my sister, because I can only think of one name I can ever call you, and that's the queen. That's the queen of all creation on this earth. If nobody ever told you that, who was dark and a black man, I'm telling you that now. I see that you have made some of the same mistakes that I have made previously in my life, that when I was hurt by black women, I went to a Spanish woman, not because the Spanish woman was better, but it was just the rejection. And so I had to look at myself in the mirror and look at my wife and saying, why is I'm here? Why is I'm really here? My heart is not here. And I end up getting divorced with my Spanish wife, not because she wasn't a true woman. It's because my true desire is my nature. My nature is a African woman. And so you can never get away from that. And you have to know this, of all God's creation, I don't know what your definition of God is, but for all creation, the most important part of his creation, he gave a son. Now, you can have to choose and use your imagination what I'm finna say right about now. He gave you a son, and that son you got can produce the greatest diversity men or women on this planet. That's why you are much sought after. And I understand what you did was you went with power. And see, black men in this time, in this state, we are powerless, even though we don't know this. And black women, you were bit by the same dog. So I say this to you, and I ask a favor of you. If you have written a book like that, I ask you to pull it from the shelf, from your God inside of you. I wrote a book too, but I never could release it because it covers some of the same things you said, but just on the other side. But this ain't the kind of conversation I want to be in public to let everybody know our dirty laundry. I wanted to do it private, and I've been working my whole life to do these kind of things private among us. And thank you for your time. I really enjoy the way you talk, and I take everything else off the radio.
All right. Thanks, Askia. Kola, you want to respond, or you want to take another call?
Well, let's just move on, because I just think it's ridiculous. You know, not that I don't agree with the sentiment. I feel the same way. But I just feel that, you know, why are you telling me all this? I, you know, like Natalie Coe's book, for instance, I feel just like Natalie. I want a tall, handsome Denzel Washington. You know, they keep blaming us when the reality is most Black American men don't even like Black women unless, like I said, they look like Alicia Keys or Halle Berry, mixed-looking, high yellow. You know, they don't honor me. They don't treat me like I'm pretty or nice or desirable. So I just find it absolutely flabbergasting that now all of a sudden I went with someone who was always there after me, giving me everything. And now, you know, it just flabbergasts me about Black men. I mean, they just, to me, are ridiculous because Black women don't have the choices you had compared to any women and are. I mean, and just the disrespect that Black American women have to go through with Black men. As an African woman, I just can't put up with being a baby mama. I can't put up with not being celebrated. I can't put up with always a white woman face put in front of mine by a Black man. I just cannot tolerate it. And so, you know, I don't know what else to say other than I truly do not hate Black men. My Black sons have their Black father. He takes them every weekend, and they stay with him. And that was before I got married. But this Black father is a wonderful man. He's in their lives, and my sons are proud to be Black. They understand why I am with Jason, and they love Jason. And it just, you know, I dated my cousin. I dated Simon Hansu. I dated many Black men, and, you know, they just, oh, God, they just don't like us.
All right. Well, hang on, because we got some more folks who want to talk to you. Hang on, Kola. 800-450-7876. Let's try line six. Warren's in the district. Warren's in D.C. Warren, you're on with Kola Boof. Is Warren there? All right. Let's try line five. Let's try Michael.
Thanks for taking my call. Hello?
Yeah, you're on the air, Michael.
Thanks for taking my call. First of all, I'd like to say to Sister that I'm sorry for how we act. But I also say to you, at the age you are, Black men, Black women, in the year 2014, we don't know the conditions that have been put on us. We are Black Anglo-Saxons. We go to their school. We go to their churches. We believe in their God. Understand that. We are confused people. We don't even like ourselves as men. So it's hard to like
us. I know all that.
Listen,
I know all that.
Hang on a second, Kola. Let him finish on that. Let you respond.
What has that got to do with a Black man asking me on a date instead of a fat, toothless white chick across the street?
All right. Hang on, Kola. Let him make his point.
I know all that already.
Well, you know it.
The dynamic. What you need to do is talk to your sons and your Black boys. You need to raise your sons.
Can I finish?
Hang on, Kola. Let him finish.
Am I allowed to finish? I'm not hating on what you're saying. You're absolutely telling the truth. But what you just said, train our sons. But see, you know.
I think we must have lost.
Okay. I'm glad it's not me.
No, I think the call might have dropped. 800-450-7876. Let's go to line three and see if this is Abdul in Seattle. Is this Abdul? On line three?
Yes, can you hear me?
Sure, go ahead. You're on with Kola Boof.
Yes, thanks for taking my call, Carl, and good day to your guests as well. I just wanted to premise this by saying, you know, I'm a 30-year-old Black man, and I know for sure, you know, what she speaks of. But I think that a lot of the issue that us young Black men deal with is a case of what we see in the media. They try to portray as if, you know, these recessive traits are what's beautiful in society. And I am here to tell you that since I know what I know today, that I know that I will only deal with Black women. And I know you spoke on your tribe. Are you familiar with the Botswana tribe?
Hello? Botswana tribe?
Yes.
I know Botswana, the country.
Well, so I read a book from a gentleman. He said he was from the Botswana tribe, and in this book, he spoke on why we shouldn't deal with the other race, basically on a premise of of
every African tribe feels that way. Every tribe. My tribe is against interracial. Every tribe in Africa is that way. We all feel that way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I'm being educated by you as well, you know.
Right. We all feel that way. The thing that I'm, what is getting to me right now, and let me just take what you're saying is and tell you something about Africa, is that we have all these African presidents who married white women who, you know, this is thrown in our face. For some reason, black men don't think we have self-pride as black women. They don't think that when you, okay, let me take a good, Wale, the Nigerian singer from Washington, D.C., made a music video called Pretty Girl. No black women in it. Wall-to-wall white women. That affects us. And so that's what I'm telling you. It's not against you, Abdullah. I hope I said your name right.
Abdullah.
It's not against you or what you're saying. I agree with what you're saying. Most black women are much more pro-black than black men. Most of us want a black man. Most of us do. But we are. We can't make you. We can't. Wait a minute. We can't make you be there. Hearing all this stuff is meaningless. Because what you're basically saying is, look, we're with the white chicks, but you just wait on us. And you just, you know, here's some black nationalist talk for you to listen to while most of us are over here with the white chicks. And, you know, you just chew on that until you become old women and nobody ever did. You know, that it just is meaningless what you're saying unless it changes in the society. We aren't the problem. Black women aren't.
I'm not saying that at all.
You turned your back on us.
No,
we didn't
turn
our backs on black men. You turned your back on us.
But listen, when you say you, you're saying that in a broad perspective. You must know that
the mass of black men, right? Because black American men are the most self-hating. Well, not the most. The UK British men, because I lived in England, are even worse. But you guys really need to just stop and take look at yourself.
But you got to understand that we're also being deprogrammed as well. Like a lot of people are being taught the truth at the same time. And this is an ongoing battle in this country. And a lot of us
I agree with all what you're saying. I'm just saying that I can't do anything about it. One single woman.
That's why we have to have conversations like this.
You read my books. Everything you're telling me is in my book. I say the same thing you say. I totally don't want us to be erased. Don't want our race to be bred out. I preach against that, you know. But at the same time, no black men for me. They're not for me in any way. Not even at the post office to say, "You want to go next?" I mean, there's no white women in our face, left and right.
Right.
I tell you what. In the interest of time, because we move on, Abdul. Kola, I guess I got a request for somebody wants you to talk about your book about the sexy part of the Bible. That's what you call it, and because it basically it's you know feeds into what you've been saying right now, the conversations you've had with Catherine and with Abdul as well. I see we're coming up on a break, but if you can get into that, and then we'll take some other calls for you because a lot of folks want to get you. And guys, if you just put in a question form so that she can respond and we can keep it flowing. And I guess some more questions from Facebook and Twitter for Kola Boof. The number to call, speak to her, is 800-450-7876. I'll give you that number again. It's 800-450-7876. When we come back, if you can speak to us about the sexy part of the Bible, that's the title of your book, about the bleaching and the skin whitening that's going on. We'll take your calls for Kola Boof in about 2.5 minutes. And we're back, folks, with Kola Boof. And I thank you for staying with us and reaching out to us at 800-450-7876. Before we take the calls, though, Kola, if you can briefly tell us about the book, The Sexy Part of the Bible, and why you titled that, and what's going on there.
Okay, the book is called The Sexy Part of the Bible because in the 1600s, when the missionaries came to West Africa and they were trying to, you know, make everyone be Christian, many of them started marrying the African native women. And so the Church of England stepped in and, you know, was very upset about that. And so the church told them to rape the women and throw them back into the, you know, jungle and referred to them, these raped women, as the sexy part of the Bible. You know, the white woman is the virtue of the Bible. Her hand is fair. The black woman is the sexy part of the Bible. Her hand is wicked. was the same. And so that was in the 1600s. So today, you know, the novel jumps forward to a black man named Seahorse Tweed. Seahorse wants to be the president of his country, and he falls in love with a black woman, Eternity, who, it turns out, white people have been, these white scientists have been experimenting on her. And so Seahorse and Eternity, a black man and a black woman, fall in love, and I'm leaving out a lot because, you know, you got to read the book, but they fall in love, and they're fighting against skin bleaching in their country. They're trying to stop this mentality among the Africans who swallow the Michael Jackson skin lightening pill. I know
in America. I'll tell you what we'll do, Kola, because in the interest of time, we'll have you come back and talk about the book, because we've got a bunch of folks who want to talk to you and got questions for you on. And folks are telling me to get these folks on. So let's go to line five. Chris is in Texas. Chris, you have a question for Kola?
Yeah, what's up, Carl? How you doing, Kola?
Hi.
I'm trying to understand here because I caught a little bit of what you said earlier, but it cut in and out. And so I heard you say you refer to all black men as nigger stock. I don't know if I misheard you, but.
You misheard me because I refer to all black people who are self-haters, for instance, skin bleachers,
uh-huh,
nigger stock. People were engineered to think only what white people want them to think. Stock.
Okay. So nigger stock doesn't.
But black people worldwide, everywhere.
Who are self-haters, you refer to as nigger stock, right?
Right, and who are active self-haters, meaning people who, like, have you seen the images of the baseball player who turned himself white?
Yeah, Sammy Sosa. I'm aware of all that. I just wanted to make sure I understood you correctly.
Well, also, I'm not talking about Denzel and Pauletta. I'm not talking about, you know, Lauryn Hill. I'm talking about the people that are actively poisoning us with the idea that we must become white, that you shouldn't marry a black woman, all of that kind of stuff. Because I've never said don't marry a black man, but plenty of men are constantly saying don't marry a black woman.
And now, Kola,
I married a black man. But
go ahead. Let me ask you. So, because I'm not too familiar with you, but I've seen little bits and pieces in the media here and there. And I'm just, I know there's a wide range of different complexions and all this with African people. So I know you're not just picking on Alicia Keys and Mariah Carey. I get what you're saying, light skin, all that mix. Yeah, I get that. But what I don't understand is when you say that black men won't talk to you or they're not trying to rescue you, that type of thing, I just don't get it because you did say that you were a whore. And I don't know, you also said that you grew up kind of listen or under the influence of somebody like a Mary Baraka. When did you become a whore, and do you think that kind of pushed you away from a lot of
people? Let me tell you, since you decided to put that like that, let me put this like this, and hold on to your balls right now. Black women become whores when there's nobody to protect them. So you left out part of the story. Who was supposed to be protecting me and watching out for me from being molested, abused by all these men? Who is the person who's supposed to be there? So that's what we're talking about, sir.
Okay, I'm asking. So you're saying that black men didn't protect you from becoming a whore?
And let me tell you something else. I'm not ashamed of it, that I was with the woman. I don't consider myself a whore, but I'm not ashamed of anything I've done as a woman. No, wait a minute. Now I'm mad. This is what
Now you're disrespecting me, though, and maybe this is part of the turnoff. Maybe this is part of the turnoff that black men have. I'm trying to understand your story. So I'm asking you a question.
No, you're not trying to understand. You're trying to be
you're not answering the question.
Hateful black man towards a black woman. If I was a white woman on this show, you'd be talking about you understand my pain and what I've been through and how nobody helped me and this and that and the other.
No, I wouldn't. You're making an assumption.
Wait a minute. One of your black daughters marries a white man. Suddenly she's trash. Yet you think every white woman is supposed to have a black man. Look at what a hypocrite you are. Maybe if you stayed and raised your daughters, and you didn't have 70%.
Hang on a second, Kola, because give him a chance to express what he's trying to say.
Maybe
hang on, Kola.
Maybe his daughters wouldn't be in trouble.
All right, Kola, hang on a second, because I don't think you're getting it. Give him a chance. Let's give him a chance to say what he's trying to say. Chris, go ahead. I think we lost Chris. Okay, let's keep going. Let's go to line three. Let's try Michael in Ohio. Michael?
Michael, hello?
Yes, you're on the air with Kola Boof.
Michael, again, I am trying to ask. I hear your anger. I understand you're mad, but you're the first to birth the black woman. Now, you're angry about what your sons and the sons of black women do. What is your plan to cure us? Because I just told you we've been conditioned to live their lifestyle.
I just told you how I raised my black sons.
Can I finish there?
I told you how I raised my black sons.
Well, hang on, Kola. Let him finish. Let him finish, Kola. Hang on a second. Go ahead, Michael.
Colin, please. I'm with you, Colin, but I also want you to understand that you know what we've been through, Colin. You know, as black men and black women, sisters hate sisters. Brothers hate brothers. Where does this come from, Colin? From the system we live in, trying to live in their standards. Now, Colin, I ask you, what are sisters and brothers out there? We've been talking this mess for the last 500-600 years. When are we going to stop and tell our preachers to stop preaching that lie and start telling us something to create our own standards? Because we hate each other, and this is the product of what they want. They don't have to do anything because we hate each other now. When do we or you come up with a book that's going to say, what do I do to save my men?
That's a good question. Kola, is there? I think we may have lost Kola. But that's a good question. First we've got to, Michael, we've got to acknowledge that we've been programmed to hate each other. And it takes a while for us to understand that. You understand it, obviously, because you mentioned it, and I'm sure a lot of other conscious brothers and sisters out there who understand that we've been programmed to hate each other. That's part of the game, and some of us don't really understand it to its fullest, and we play into it, and we're still hating on each other instead of loving each other, and we're still just as like we mentioned earlier. Some people think the white man's ice is colder, his sugar sweeter, and his water wetter. Some people think that the white person is much, much better. So that's part of the problem too. So Michael, what would you suggest?
My suggestion is one of the backgrounds we got is the church. Now we know that the church, we all know it's good, but remember, we're not religious people, we're spiritual people. And that's the advantage, or what they took the advantage of that over us when they sent the missionaries in. But as slaves, we came here and we were conditioned to act the way we act. And this is the finished product, hating each other. My thing is, the only backbone we got now, because we ain't going to the schools, we ain't going to the public town meetings, we ain't having meetings ourselves. So the only place we do go, and most of our women go, because the men are a little shy going to church anymore because it hasn't produced anything, is the preacher. It's the Bible that's got our chains attached to a way we think. We're sitting on a bench waiting for a white God to fall out of the sky and save us. When it's us, we've been here before them. This woman that's talking to me is the first to birth. She's the first woman to ever have a child on this planet. So I say to you, brothers and sisters out there, go to your churches and ask churches, preachers for justice. We got to quit telling this lie and sitting there waiting on somebody to come. We've been waiting for thousands of years.
But Michael, here's the deal too, because a lot of us aren't going into the churches. So is there another avenue that we could take?
I think the other avenue is that we start repair centers, community meetings. We go to the libraries or wherever we can go and start to repair ourselves. Do we want to be in this type of religion? Do we want to live in this type of standards? Because see, the standards that white men put in front of us are unnatural for us. This isn't the way. We can't survive like this. And he sees that. Do you hear us on your show? You're listening. And it's been, these are educated black men and women that torture each other. We're still talking about the light skin and the dark skin. When we know what he's done to us, black coffee, now he done put all kind of cream and sugar in it.
Michael, we got to take a break, but thank you. And you know, what you mentioned is what Dr. Francis Gress Wilson talked to us about. Hopefully we can get Kola back. There's someone lost on the line. She's trying to dial back in. If you guys can in the studio can pick her back up. 800-450-7876, the number to call. Speak to Kola Boof. We'll take your calls in about 2.5 minutes. Thank you for staying with us, folks. Our guest, Kola Boof, a writer, African writer, and I know all different kinds of things. Her latest book is Sexy Part of the Bible. We'll get into that next time we meet. But right now, listen, because these folks have been calling and trying to get to speak to her, let's try. Kola, are you still with us?
Got me back on.
Okay, hang on there. All right, let's go to West on line one. He's in Atlanta, Georgia. West, you're on with Kola Boof. You have a question for Kola Boof?
Hey, how you doing, Carl? Hey, Miss Kola, on behalf of every black man on this planet, I want to apologize to you and every sister that we have unfortunately wronged and was unable to protect you. Okay, that's what I want to do. That's what I call it, because I feel your pain. And I feel my brothers and sisters' pain, but just a case of please forgive us.
Well, I love you for that. I love you so much. I love you. I love you. I love you. I just want you to know that. Don't think that, you know, I don't hear you. I do. And I don't blame every black man at all. I just, you know, I don't know what I was supposed to do. It's like, you know, it's all like in the past now. I don't know what to do. I'm married now, so what can I do? I marry my husband? I can't do that. I really like him, and he's good to me. But I love you so much, and I wish that I could have married a good black man who wanted to, you know.
We're
all fighting.
It's being manipulated, ma'am, okay? Just look up a website called StopTheCrime.net. And you will see how we being manipulated with this mind control, where they turning each of us against each other. This is by design, so we must have to fight this. And basically, it's all tone and frequency, how we talk to each other, and we can turn this around. And like I say, I'm apologize to you and every black woman on this planet for the atrocities that we have done. It's the case of please forgive us, because really, we do not know what we do. Okay, me and you. And everybody else with melanin in our skin, and just go to StopTheCrime.net and show your young brothers, your sons, that we love y'all black women. Because I really do. I came from a black. My mom was black at midnight, 12:30, and I'm 6'5", and it took me a while to get here. But like I say, I just want to apologize. I really love you. I wish I could see you. I'm going to try to get your book.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Wes. Okay. Thank you, Carl. We're going to keep moving.
What a wonderful guy. Thank you so much.
800-450-7876, line 3. Let's go to Bob in Texas. Bob, you're on with Kola Boof. You have a question for her?
Yes. Got a question. First of all, Carl, I've heard you tell callers not to ever use that word on your show, the N-word, but yet this lady is able to use it with liberty. I don't understand that. The second thing is, it was mentioned that Osama bin Laden was very racist against blacks, and I guess so he used derogatory words against blacks, but your guest still spread her legs for him. So if y'all could answer both of those questions, I'd appreciate it.
All right. That's go ahead.
By Osama bin Laden, and see, this is where these black men make me so upset. Do you not know what the Arab world is? What woman has a right to spread or unspread her legs in the Arab world? Why do you even use language like that when women in Africa are not even
free? Why do you use the N-word?
They own their own bodies.
Use the N-word.
All right, Bob, give her a chance to respond. Hang on, because Kola, you've got to understand.
No,
a lot of people that you're talking to have not traveled. they don't understand the different cultures. Please understand their sensibilities. They're working within their circumference, which is the United States of America. Most of them are just in their neighborhoods. So you've got to understand that. So that's what we have here is sort of cultural difference.
To me, I think that he's using that N-word as an excuse to be angry. I didn't have a choice about being with Osama. That was against my will. There was nothing that I could do but survive it. But
what's your derogatory
against
what? What's the name you use for Arabs rape black women? Do you have a word for Arabs that rape black women like you? Because you have the N-word. What's your word for Arabs that rape black women?
I call them the same thing.
The what?
I call them the same thing. Pick up some of my books, because I call them the same thing and worse. And I call them names and that.
All right, we're going to keep moving because we're going to get stuck on the N-word with Bob. He's got a thing about the N-word. Bob,
and
sorry about that.
We've
got to keep moving.
You got a thing about the N-word, Carl. Let's keep moving.
800-450-7876. You're not going to get past it. You hung up on it, you hung up on it, and that's part of the problem with some of us. We just hung up on one particular thing, and you just can't see beyond it. Whether it's a person or an issue, we just can't get beyond it. And that's sad because the world is much, much bigger and much larger. I had a question for you from someone on Facebook wanted to know about Bin Laden. Was he left-handed? Was he a southpaw?
He wanted everyone to think he was. He used both hands, but it was like an act with the left hand, just like an act with his kidneys. He was not really on dialysis. That's true. He had some problems with cramping in his feet, but a lot of the things were things he created for psychological reasons, he said, and also as ways to have, you know, a particular suspect, if you're thrown off by what they're actually like, was the whole reason behind. And his friend Esam, which is called Sam, who was his best friend, they raised horses together. That there, you know, that was the as a business was their horse raising. Esam is the woman who up that whole, you know, told him to do that and created that.
Interesting. 800-450-7876. A book is called The Sexy Part of the Bible, and kind of controversial, so people don't understand. You know, like I've got to mention, repeat again, because it's a cultural thing. Even though you've been in the States and you grew up in Washington, D.C., Anacostia area, some people don't understand what you're talking about. Many have not been to Africa. Many have not been to the Arab part of Africa either. So for them, some of the things that you talk about is sort of foreign, and they take offense to it. What we're trying to say, and Michael even said that if you could write something positive and understand that both sides have been brainwashed, that, you know, we're being used.
Well, so, this is the thing about, they haven't read my book. If they did, they wouldn't say, why don't you write something positive? Go and just read the reviews of The Sexy Part of the Bible, which is about a black man and a black woman in love. Go and read the reviews and also Flesh and the Devil. I don't write negative books to attack one side or the other, but I think black people are so used to everything being about race and about them and about their struggle, but they forget that black women have to not only be black, but women as well. And we go through a lot of abuse from the white race and black men. And if we talk about it in public, then suddenly this is what happened. You know, everyone, this is just what happened with Amiri Baraka that day, when the whole audience of, you know, and I was telling nothing but the truth. That's what I was invited there to speak on, was colorism. But for some reason, when black people hear the truth spoken, that, hey, we put the yellow people up front, we put the darkest in the back, they become upset, even though clearly this is the truth. Everyone can speak. And so they become upset when a woman is speaking. If I was a man, I'd be welcome next to them because I would be speaking out against the white this and that, and I wouldn't know what women go through, so I wouldn't bring up one. And they just love it. But you have to women.
You kind of faded in and out. So if you can get to a good spot so we can hear you real good. But I want to get the question about what's going on in Nigeria with the gays now. They've outlawed homosexuality in Nigeria. And they said that you had some insight.
Yeah, I was very upset about it because also anyone who helps take care of gays will face 10 years. The gays get 15 years in prison for being gay. But let's say someone has AIDS and you're a caretaker and you take care of them, you will go to prison for 10 years under what they call being part of a gay organization just by helping them or friend. And so I just feel this is so inhuman. It's terrible. If you don't like gays, that's one thing, but I don't think any human being, and nowhere in the Bible does God tell us to persecute people. Nowhere in the Bible does God tell us to be hateful and racist or, you know, homophobic or whatever against people. God says that he is the judge. And Jesus said that, you know, his only one commandment is love. And so it's so evil in my for the Nigerian government to pass an anti-gay law, and then the next day they started arresting people that they suspect as homosexuals in wagons at night, just like Nazi Germany. I mean, going at night. And a lot of these people are not gay, Carl. One of my friends in particular, who I'm upset that he was arrested and taken from his home, I can vouch for him. He is not gay. But every time the over
but
there...
But you've been quoted in the Nigerian papers as offering them advice. What advice did you offer to the Nigerian gays?
Oh, I told the Nigerian gays that if Christians come to them as mobs to kill them, that they need to kill the Christians. And I would tell that to any black people of any kind. If someone is hunting you down like an animal because they feel that they are superior to you, then you have every right to pick up a weapon and kill them back. And the gays need to stop being afraid and huddling. And I mean, if you're going to die anyway, go out fighting. Go out fighting. Grab you a can of gasoline and throw on those Christians and burn them alive.
But is it the Christians or the Muslims in Nigeria pushing this?
What did you say?
Is it the Christians or the Muslims who are pushing this?
The Christians are the ones who, they're both pushing it, but a Christian president signed the bill, and the Christians are the one who were rounding up people the other night. The Muslims have not, you know where the Muslims live in Nigeria, in Kano and other northern areas, and their particular sections, they don't really know anybody who's gay because the people are so frightened. Who would, you know? But in the Christian areas, they have people who, like my friend was arrested because he had an album by Luther Vandross. And so they're saying if you have all Luther Vandross albums, you must be gay.
Wow. I tell you what, we got to stop it right there because we're just out of time. Kola, we'll do it again real soon. I want to thank you.